சார் ஒரு குமரன் சார்
போராட்டம்.
காரங்களா சார் பண்றாரு சார். ஓகே சார்.
குமரன் சார்
ஆ எஸ்
ரெடியா இருக்கீங்களா?
ஆ ரெடியா இருக்க சார்.
ஓகே சார்.
சரி சார் கொஞ்சம் ஹெச்ஓடி சார்
சார் நீங்க இன்ட்ரோடக்ஷன் சார். ஓகே சார் ஆரம்பிச்சிடலாம் சார்.
இல்ல என்ன கொஞ்சம் பாத்துட்டு செஞ்சீங்களா இப்ப கொடுத்துடலாமா?
இல்ல எவ்வளவு மெம்பர்ஸ் இருக்காங்க சார் பாருங்க.
49 இருக்கு.
இன்னொரு 75 வரட்டும் சார். 75 வரட்டும்.
சரி சார்
இன்னொரு ஃபேமிலி கூப் பண்ணுங்க சார்.
Good morning, one and all. Dear participants, kindly mute your audio and video. The second day FDP webinar organizes by the Department of History, Government Arts College, Nandanam, Chennai 35. The theme of recent trend on historical, cultural, art and architecture. I call upon Professor Dr. R. Kumaran, Associate Professor of History, to welcome address and introduce the resource person. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon to all. On behalf of the PhD and research department.
சார் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணுங்க. குமரன் சார், குமரன் சார், ஹலோ குமரன் சார், ஜனார்தன் சார்,
என்னாச்சு
பாருங்க.
அவருக்கு வந்து ஏதோ இந்த வைஃபை ப்ராப்ளம் எதுவும் இருக்குல்ல சார், நெட்வொர்க் எரரா இருக்கு. ஹலோ குமரன் சார்,
ஹலோ குமரன் சார், குமரன் சார், சார் வந்திருக்கிறாரா? சார்
வரல, உள்ள வரல அவரு சார். இன்னும் வந்திருக்காரு, வந்திருக்காரு. ஆ
கொடுங்க சார். சார் பேசுங்க குமரன் சார். சவுண்ட் சவுண்ட் ஆடியோ ஆடியோ ஆன் பண்ணுங்க.
அன்மியூட் பண்ணீங்க சார். அன்மியூட் பண்ணிட்டு பேசுங்க சார். உங்க ஆடியோ இது வந்து மைக் மியூட்ல இருக்கு. அன்மியூட் பண்ணிட்டு பேசுங்க
சார். ஆடியோ அன்மியூட் பண்ணுங்க சார்.
மைக் மைக் பட்டன் மைக் வந்து இது பண்ணுங்க சார். அன்மியூட் பண்ணுங்க சார். ஸ்கிரீனை டச் பண்ணுங்க. ஸ்கிரீனை டச் பண்ணி அந்த மைக் வந்து அன்மியூட் பண்ணிடுங்க.
உங்களுது மைக் ஆன் ஆகல பாருங்க. குமரன் சார், குமரன் சார்,
கேக்குதா?
ஆ கேக்குது கேக்குது, பேசுங்க. கேக்குது சார். சார் பேசுங்க. மறுபடியும் மைக் அன்மியூட் ஆயிடுச்சு சார். மைக் அன்மியூட் ஆயிடுச்சு சார். குமரன் சார்,
வெளில போயிட்டார் சார்.
HOD sir. HOD sir. கவரர் சார்
சார் வந்தார் சார்
சார் அவர்
வந்துட்டார் வந்துட்டார் சார் வந்துட்டாரு ஸ்பிரிட் பண்ணியாச்சு
நெட் திருப்பி போட்டாங்க நெட் நெட் தான் வீடியோ வீடியோ ஆன் பண்ணல இல்ல
குமரன் சார்
அர சார் என்ன மைக் கனெக்ட் டிஸ்கனெக்ட் ஆச்சோ
இல்ல இப்ப கரெக்டா இருக்கா
ஆ
ஆ சார் பேசுங்க சார் சார்
அப்படியே பேசுங்க சார் சார்
கண்டினியூ பண்ணுங்க அப்படி கண்டினியூ பண்றேன்
ஆ பண்ணுங்க
தி டெக்னிக்கல் கோஆர்டினேட்டர் டாக்டர் கோதண்டராமன் our librarian and organizing committee and faculty members of our PG and research department of history and I welcome to all the faculty of departments of various institutions research scholars students and all my dear friends I likewise want to offer my welcome and thanks to our honorable chief guest Dr. M. Seran and experts archaeologists to government of Tamil Nadu state department of archaeology at Keeladi cluster of archaeological excavation sites near Madurai who has acknowledged our encouragement to direct this webinar for self improvement he possesses more than 30 years of architecture, iconography, and ceramic types of South India and in the world, having imparted such knowledge to postgraduate students, research scholars, experts, and commoners through classroom lectures, seminars, presentations, exchange of views among the scholars, and basic ancient ceramics knowledge. To common folk during the excavations and explorations. Acquired postgraduate MA degree in ancient history and archaeology, University of Madras, and won the gold medal for three departments. Pursued research MPhil PhD in the same department, had training in preservation and conservation antiquities, under water archaeology, applications of remote sensing for archaeology, served that department as technical assistant, technical officer, and lecturer for 3 decades. Participated in more than 12 sites and trained around 30 batches of final years PG students of the department in the excavations. And similarly, same number of batches of first year students in explorations. Lead a few batches of postgraduates come research students to various places of education them and educated them the intricacies of art, architecture, religion, society through different styles of Indian art and architecture. He is specialized in field work, pre-proto history, art and architecture, early historical archaeology, and analysis of ceramics types of India. More than 10 research articles pertained to the above field published, given special lectures to other departments and colleges of the university on field of archaeology, significance of forts, and the relevance of archaeology to other fields, co-authored Palu excavations report by contributing critical remarks of the ceramics excavation, excavated, also jointly contributed an international chapter on non-scriptural graffiti of Arikadi excavations and Indo-Roman trading centers located in Pondicherry in collaborations with Pennsylvania University, supported the Indo-Japanese megalithic project of Tokyo University, associated with cultural attaché of Italy on centers of Indo-Roman trade. We are proud to organize seminars constantly for all to gain information and to be effectively associated with all the recent updates to achieve a great things ahead. I humbly welcome you to Dr. Theran sir to take over the second day of the session to enlighten one and all present here on the title New Vistas of Keeladi and Archaeological Finds. Nowadays he is also engaged in the Keeladi Archaeological Survey movements, and I best wishes you sir, and I once again welcome you sir for delivering a nice lecture. Thank you sir.
Thank you sir.
Can I join you sir?
Yes sir.
Yes. Good afternoon to everyone who have gathered. Let me express my sense of gratitude to Professor Thangaraj, who has given me a chance to share my experiences on this platform of webinar, international webinar. My association with Keeladi since its excavation in the year 2014 to this season, that is the sixth season, I am associated with both the Archaeological Survey of India as well as the State Department of Archaeology in all these six seasons. And thanks to the invitation initially extended by Amarnath Ramakrishna, who happens to be a product of Madras University, whom I have trained in the field during excavation and exploration, design handling classes in the postgraduate level. To start with, in the annals of South Indian context, in 1863, when Robert Bruce Wood picked up the Paleolithic tool at Pallavaram, which has opened a new chapter as in the archaeological perspective of it. Since then, the new sites started emerging, and it attracted the scholars to probe information and add historical facts for history writing and historiography of Tamil Nadu in particular. In the year 1888, excavations were conducted at Paravai, Anupanadi, which are a suburb of Madurai city. It was conducted by Alexander Ree. It was he who once again conducted the Adichanallur excavation in the year 1904. After 100 years of Alexander Ree's excavation at Adichanallur, in 2003 and 2004, Archaeological Survey of India under the aegis leadership of Dr. T. Satyamurthy conducted the excavation, and they were also unearthed new findings from the megalithic site, urn burial site. In this context, let me add up the information on how archaeology gained momentum in Tamil Nadu during 1945, when Mortimer Wheeler conducted the excavation at Arikampedu. It really opened a new chapter in a more scientific and systematic way of digging and revealing those hidden treasures for the exposition of the ancient culture, and in particular, it opened the relationship of the Tamils who had transoceanic contacts with the Greco-Roman world. Then, in the year 1950, when Professor Raman was serving Archaeological Survey of India as one of the officers, he had conducted the village survey in and around Madurai, covering Madurai, Theni, Dindigul, Periyakulam taluks, and he identified many important archaeological sites around Madurai. In fact, that alone paved way for the present excavator who initiated the excavation in the year 2014-15, Mr. Amarnath Ramakrishna, to probe more informations and explore and discover many more sites on either banks of the river Vaigai, starting from its origin at Surulimalai, Vallimalai, which is in Western Ghats of the natural mountain barrier, and from there it collected water of Suruliyar, Manjalar, and it traveled through many districts like Theni, Dindigul, Madurai, Ramanathapuram, and finally entered into the Bay of Bengal at Aathangarai, very near to it was the place Azhagankulam, wherein the Tamil Nadu Government Department of Archaeology conducted the excavation and confirmed of the Roman contacts. In the year 1963, excavation at the Kaveri Pumbatinam, the estuary point or the port city of the Sangameshwaras, given a clinching issue as far as the rate is concerned. That excavation, which was conducted between 62 to 72, then 73 to 75, it was continued. In these years, three major structural activities, brick structure, were unearthed, and one of which is the WAP, a jetty which contained wooden logs, and the wooden logs portions were sent for carbon dating, and the same was given a date of 280 BC, and based on that, the Sangam literature, in particular, which eulogized the prowess of the port city of the early Sangam Chola port city, namely Kaveri Pumbatinam or Pumbuhar, from the literatures like Silapadigaram, Manimegalai, and Pattinapalai. In all these literature, we get vivid accounts of how the city existed. For example, Pattinapalai gives the city division as Pattinapalai gives states the city in two divisions, Pattinapakkam and Marur Pakkam. And when it talks about the commodities which were brought into the port city, how the things came in to Pumbuhar city and how they got transported to the other countries, not only other parts of South India or the Indian subcontinent, but also of the other worlds, Sri Lanka, Southeast Asia, and Far East, then to the Western nation, namely the Greco-Roman world. The literature clearly states, "Ponnodu vandu periyodu peyandu." These are all the statements which clearly gives us an indication how the Romans or the Greek people had their trade contacts with South India, in particular the Tamils, and as a matter of exchange, they brought in coal, and in return, they having laden with many sacks, gunny bags of pepper, consumable quality, consumable product, they have taken it to their country. During Augustus period, there was an ordinance which clearly states, as a matter of request to the traders, the ordinance stated, hereafter, the traders of the Roman world are advised not to have much trade, venture pepper trade, and as a result of that, the treasury of the state got drained in more than 50% of it. So kindly have a restriction over such a trade. That was the ordinance passed by Augustus government. So which clearly states how the Indian paper traveled to the extreme Greco-Roman world, and in turn
we also unearthed the Greco-Roman potteries, Roman intaglios from sites like Arikamedu, Adaganpulam, Kavaripurnu. In all these sites, we have got these type of antiquities. So, which clearly proves the interrelationship on the basis of trade. Then, in the year 1976, Archaeological Survey of India conducted the excavation at Teekallupatti, so which had given another angle of approach. It was a site in the Tamil Nadu context. From the stratified deposit, the white painted, black and red ware, kaolin painted pottery was recovered from the stratified deposit, and as a result, it had had a link with that of the Andhra people on the basis of the artistic nature of the pottery. Then in the year 1980, excavation at Kovalan Puttal was conducted by the State Department of Archaeology. Between 86 and 2017, the same department, that is State Department of Archaeology, conducted excavation at Adankulam in seven long seasons. Between 89 and 92, after which means Mortimer Wheeler conducted the excavation at Arikamedu in the year 1945. Before him, Cassol conducted the French archaeologist Cassol conducted an excavation at Arikamedu, and after Mortimer Wheeler, it was the Department of Ancient Eastern Archaeology in collaboration with the Pennsylvania University conducted excavation between 89 and 92, and during these three seasons, we also recovered many antiquities very much conforming the Indo-Roman trade of the Tamil land with that of the Roman world. Besides the antiquities, we also recovered, unearthed the dyeing vats. So here we could relate such type of architectural features unearthed from Arikamedu. Prior to Arikamedu, there are also other sites, and such sites are none other than Urayur, which was also excavated by the Department of Ancient Eastern Archaeology, which revealed dyeing vats. And in a similar way, right now, Kiredi, from the second season to a stretch of more than 30 square meters, revealed the structural complex completely of bricks and mud plastering, very much associated and closely built structure having chambers, tanks, water chutes, open canal. All this very much pertain to the weaving industry had been excavated. And in that context, the fifth season excavation at Kiredi by the State Department of Archaeology also revealed such tanks. So this very well confirms the dyeing unit which existed in various parts of Tamil Nadu proves its might as one of the popular common industries of common cottage industries of the contemporary period of the early centuries of the Christian era of the Tamils. When we set into Kiredi in particular, in the year 2013 and 14, Amarnath Ramakrishna, who happened to be the supervening archaeologist of the Bangalore excavation wing of Archaeological Survey of India, had intentionally, purposefully conducted the long survey starting from the origin point of River Vaigai till its estuary point at Adagankulam, covering more than 250 kilometers of stretch on either side. And as a result, he had discovered, revisited, although some of the sites were visited earlier, the revisitation of his exploration revealed new antiquities and findings from such sites. As a based on this exploration, the thorough exploration conducted by him with the support of the team, he discovered 293 sites, and of which 100 sites are of habitation mounds. So of the entire findings, they constitute sites of hero stones, Tamil Brahmi inscriptions, sculptures, architectural features, urn burials, megalithic burials, menhirs, hero stones, and habitation mounds. So among the 100 habitation mounds, he once again has chosen 10, and out of that 10 sites, Kiradi happens to be the largest mound to a stretch of 110 kilometers, being engulfed, well protected by the palm grove, coconut groves, without much disturbances, except the top level being tilled by the farmers. So, but for it, the entire mound is intact in its original position, covering the entire hidden treasures of the Tamils 2,500 years before present, well intact in its womb of the earth. So hence, the excavation in the year 1415 and 1516 was conducted under the leadership, stewardship of Amarnath Rama Misha. By the time, I was also invited by him as expert to visit the site. Since then, I had the opportunity of having my personal experiences and interactions with the site. This is the sixth season work at Kiradi. During the third season, due to some peripheral chosen of the excavation spots, they couldn't find much antiquities, and as a result, Archaeology Survey of India has come to an end of closing their session of conducting the excavation, and thereupon the Tamil Nadu government, State Department of Archaeology, had taken up that excavation since 2017-18, 18-19, and this is the sixth season work. And presently, with the able guidance of the IAS officer, T. Uday Chandran sir, commissioner, the principal secretary of the department, had given a leverage as far as the sixth season work is concerned of conducting the excavation not only at Kiradi and its cluster sites or the associated sites located in the proximity of hardly 1 to 1.5 kilometers when a crow flies over. When we have the aerial view, we could spot all these sites as cluster sites. They are Kiradi, Kondahai, Manalur, Agaram. So in all these sites, now the excavation is being continuously conducted after the lockdown period of Corona. We started working with the limited personnel and the researchers, and we started unearthing new finds from these sites. So let me get into the pictures of explaining from the four season work, as I have the interim report published very recently by Government of Tamil Nadu, and which was released during the book exhibition held at the YMCA building. And here you can see, and this is the drone picture of the excavated site. From the sky, you can see the palm grove well guarding the site and the excavated site. Trenches being spotted. This is one of the brick structures which was unearthed during the fourth season by the State Department of Archaeology brick structure. The bricks comparable to that of Arikamedu and other early historical sites of Tamil Nadu. And this is the closer view of the same. Here you come across five courses of bricks headed over the one course is headed over the other. It is quite interesting to have collected ceramics types of the early historical period, namely black and red ware, black ware, red silver ware, russet coated painted ware, white iron painted ware, and conical jar pieces. Apart from these, Areton ware, few pieces of Areton ware and rouleted wares were also collected. Celadon ware also recovered from these sites. Of the ceramic collections, we have recovered more than hundreds of graffiti shirts and 58 shirts contained Tamil letters, Tamil words, and each shirt contained the writing in different handwriting. They are not the same, which gives an indication to prove the literacy standard which the Tamils had 2500 years before present well establishes that they had a very good level of literacy. And this is the compressed state of pottery recovered during the fourth season. And this is the black and red ware bowl, which is more than 60 centimeters of diameter recovered. It is a black and red ware. It is first of its kind. And the lower photograph is from the bottom portion of a trench, your thickness of 70 centimeters in two trenches at the same contemporary level. And both the trenches are very adjacent. In both the trenches, many cartloads of dumped pottery were recovered, which gives an indication that there could have existed potters manufacturing many thousands of vessels. And only in that context, few trenches, two trenches of measurement 5 square meter with to a thickness of 70 to 80 centimeters have yielded many cartloads of pottery dumped in that level, in the lower level. Among the antiquities, we have collections of spindle whirls. This is the basic unit of converting the cotton fiber, which is being ripened from the plants. When the cotton fibers are taken out, it is to be twisted as thread. The fibers into thread, make it as a thread. This type of spindle whirls, shaped like a pear-shaped bead of terracotta, with the iron rod inserted into it, the tip of the top tip has the hook-like provision, and wherein few fibers of the cotton loop will be twisted, and the entire thing will naturally pull the fibers from the cotton lump, and it will convert the fiber into thread, which in turn will be taken to the yarn for making dhoti or towel or the other type of dresses. And at the lower side, these are all the recovered bone implements, mostly used as arrow tips, so which gives an indication that hunting was one of the habits of the contemporary people. Among these, one such piece contained two holes on either side with the arrow tip on either side, which is shaped out of the femur bone, that is one of the limbs of human being, and that might have been used as a shuttle in order to interwoven the many hundreds of fibers to be weaved and to be converted as a thread. Here you can find, this is the pestle and mortar. Generally, such type of pestle and mortar were utilized for grinding the herbals for extraction of medicines for, to treat some kind of diseases. And similarly, on the other side, This is the comb made up of ivory. Ivory objects, not only comb, gamesman like dice were also recovered from the site. And at the bottom, you can see the bottle-shaped narrow-necked earthen vessel, which is nothing but the archaic form of thermos flask in early days, which will retain the temperature. If you pour hot water, which will be retained for 2 to 3 hours of its same temperature. And similarly, when you pour cold water, because of the narrowness of the mouth, it will retain the same temperature for some hours. And this is the bead made of silica material, silicaceous bead. We call it as a base bead of glass material. As far as glass beads are concerned, glass objects are concerned, they can be manufactured in 3 states. One is transparent, the other one is translucent, yet another state is opaque. And these beads, which are in multicolor and various shapes, you can find the centrally placed row of yellow beads have colored on either side. That is projections after the round flattened button shape. They are the colored beads. So such type of beads were also recovered in hundreds. Besides these, not only commoners' objects, even the luxury item meant for the royal people, the golden ornaments were also recovered from the four seasons, around six, seven pieces of gold ornaments, like the pendant, star-like stud portion, one broken bead, a golden bead, yet another full bead, and one broken portion of a bangle, and two more pieces were recovered. And you can see the workmanship, the closer view of the golden pendant. You can see the workmanship, even the color of the metal is will give us an indication which reflects the Sokkathangam aspect of the golden ornaments which they manufactured with the help of the goldsmith. Then at the bottom, you have the collection of another type of what you call the coral colored. It's not coral, it is also glass beads in hundreds. I was talking about the dice, which was a pastime. Invariably, Sangam literature gives information about how the royal people usually spent their leisure hours, and they had the pleasure time by playing the dice. Here you can see the closer view of the dice. The dice is, this cubical dice has 6 sides. Each side has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as the numbers encircled. That is concentric circle, one circle within the other circle. So which gives an indication, the moment we roll the dice and according to the number which had projected at the top, will naturally be the chess coin will be moved on the board. And at the bottom, you have the hopscotches, which is nothing but the common play object of the children of the village folk. Even now, in the extreme south of Tamil Nadu, right from Tanjavur, Tiruchi, Madurai, and other places, even in northern, some portions of northern Tamil Nadu, we have such type of, such a specimen of hopscotches, which is round, shaped out of pot shells, meant for hip hopping, that is pandi kodu rundi vilaiyattu. So this is the type of gamesman which existed and recovered from Kerala, from the whole season. And this illustration shows the chessman-like gamesman, which has the same shape, but only the size varies. And as for the size alone, which can be decided whether it is an elephant or a king or a queen or a pawn or bishop. And accordingly, their movements will be controlled.
of the semi precious stones we have collected, beads of carnelian, agate, banded agate, amethyst, and of the imported and imitated type of ceramics. These are all the ceramic types which Kennedy had yielded, in particular the rowletted ware and few shirts of Arretin ware. Rowletted ware, prior to the excavation of the State Department of the Department of Engineering and Archaeology of Madras University in collaboration with Pennsylvania University between 89 and 92, we were all of the impression that as per the statement and report given by Sir Mortimer Wheeler, we progressed and proceeded in that view as this rowletted ware as imported ware. But when we collaborated Pennsylvania University team led by Dr. Vimla Vegli, we come to a conclusion that these rowletted ware which were made by the internal locally available clay, and hence the locally available clay material had given us a clue, and whichever rowletted ware made out of the locally available clay had been termed as the imitated rowletted ware. That is the rowletted ware which I recovered from more than 50 sites of Tamil Nadu, and this variety is not the Roman rowletted ware. It is an indigenously made imitated ware. The technique is at the bottom on the inner side. It is flat. Generally, it is something like a shallow bowl or plate-like earthenware containing the rowletted design, which is nothing but concentric circles, either in the form of a circle, with the continuous line, or dots in concentric circles or wedges. So such pattern gives an indication and name had been given to that shirt, which has traveled all the way from the Roman world. But this technique has been imported, and the local potter imparted the same in their own made vessels. Of the terracotta images, you can find the head, bust, and the body portions. One such mold has also been recovered. This positive mold gives how they could readily make many pieces simultaneously, so easily, in order to cater to the requirement of the consumers. In a similar context, during Vinayak Chaturthi nowadays, people who readily make such images with what you call the mold and make and sell it to us. This is the pottery art. From each and every pick of the respective trenches with their dimensions and other measurements, each heap will be immediately taken and placed in the yard, and thereupon it will be given a thorough washing for statistical analysis as per variety wise and the design wise. In some cases, painted shirts will also be recovered, decorations, the graffiti shirts, and the inscribed shirts. And it is only as per this analysis we could trace 58 shirts containing Tamil words, very much recalling the good old names of the Tamil people. This is one such earthenware of blackware recovered and photographed in situ from the trench itself at the base. This is a stratigraphic This is the stratigraphic drawing illustration, and it gives us how hard, how soft, and what are the combination color, content, and texture of the stratified deposit as we go from the surface level to the lowest till we reach the natural soil. And invariably at Kiridi, the natural soil comprises of the river sand, and further beyond we won't get even a single piece of man-made object. That very well confirms that becomes the natural soil of this locality. This is a terracotta oven adupu with the decorations of the middle, and it has a few holes to let the air flow in a controlled way, so that the flame can have a controlled flame to burn and heat the vessel kept to be cooked, put to be cooked. Many trenches have revealed ring wells. This ring well is at the lowermost portion, cut into the river sand deposit, which we call it as the natural soil of this locality, which gives an indication in that contemporary level, that is the earliest level, 2500 years before present, they had the habit of erecting ring wells to tap the water adjacent to their living quarters, which shows an advanced level living standard of that people who lived over here. This is the closer view of the ring well, and over which you can see the top being when the well has not been used. Generally, our habit is to close the well with the dumping materials. Here, they have dumped the well at the upper portion with that of the potteries which accumulated, got collected in that level. Two of these shirts are with Tamil letters. The first one is of two letters, Thitta, and the second shirt is of the word Tamithi. Tamithi. So both are pre-Ashokan in nature. These are the closer view of the potteries which contain the Tamil words, and they pronounce Adan, Kubiran Adan, Sandan, Satan, Ian, and these are all the names which we come across right from the first season, second season of Kiridi excavation. We started getting these type of Tamil words, and by characters and style, some of the letters are precursors to even Ashokan Brahmi. Prior to Kiridi, we were all of the impression that the letters which we have recovered through the rock inscriptions, that is the Jaina inscriptions found in and around Madurai region, Mangalam, Arattapatti, and other places like Thadampatti and Puliman Kombai, the hero stone inscription very recently discovered by Dr. K. Rajan, professor and head of the department of Pondicherry University, who was earlier attached to Tamil University, a product of Madras University too, had discovered two popular hero stone inscriptions with Tamili characters. So all this clearly gives indication the date of these Tamil inscriptions were assigned by Dr. Airavatha Mahadevan, who had written the corpus of Indus script to and Tamil Brahmi inscriptions, and he had given the date as 3rd century BC. As for Thadampatti and Puliman Kombai hero stone inscription, and Kodumanal inscribed shirts. The Tamil University as well as Dr. Rajan had given the date as 5th century BC. As for KDD is concerned, the letters, some of the shirts which contain the precursor letter of Ashokan Brahmi has been dated on scientific basis to 580 BC, that is 6th century BC. So it has taken the Tamil letters to the age of 600 BC. So in turn, these have taken the date of Tamil literature from 3rd century BC to 6th century BC, another 3 centuries earlier. And apart from this, the finds of the structural finds as well as the literacy level and the high level of living standard from Kedadi in all these seasons has given a clinching issue and what you call authenticity to name it, that the first phase of the urban settlement of the Indian subcontinent has excavated from Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, Kalibangan, Rojdi, Lothal, and the Dholavara and the adjoining areas of 5,000 years ago, that is 5,000 years before present. Then it's a next phase of what you call urban settlement, which had its domination in and around the Gangetic Dome. And prior to KDD excavation, although we have discovered many structural features from Arikamedu, Urayur, Kaveri Pumbutinam, Adagankulam, and other sites, most of the scholars were of the opinion, particularly the North Indian scholars were of the opinion, that the South India, in particular Tamil Nadu, has not had its urban settlement. But because of very sporadic occurrence of what you call the structural activity. But now KDD, from the second season, yielded many structural activity during the second season to an extent of 300 square meters level. The adjoining clipped closeness of the structural activity of the same kind of brick, comprising of chambers, brick chambers, open channels drawing water, and U-shaped structure, which could have been the prototype of what we call the Vellavi structure. Invariably in some of the villages, even now, people have the practice of dry cleaning their clothes with the help of what you call the washerman, who keep the wet cloth over this Vellavi type of platform and turn the color, dirty color of the soiled clothes into brightened nature. So such structures were recovered from KDD. These are all the types of beads. Not only semi-precious stone, golden beads, even terracotta ear ornaments were also recovered. Glass beads, then shell beads, quartz beads, they are also recovered from they are of different colors and shapes. Spherical, tubular, twisted spherical, then what you call collared bead, button shape, etched bead, barret shape. This is the closer view of the hopscotches, which I was referring about. This is another plate revealing the fine workmanship. These are all mainly shaped out of the broken portions of the parchment. In some cases, we also recovered purposefully made terracotta hopscotches. These are all the gemsmen. You can see the same shape, but only as per the shapes. They could be identified either as the king or queen or the soldier or the bishop or elephant, something like that. In Tamil, they call it as Sokattan Kai. These are all iron implements. The curved ones are the tip portions of the what you call bilugs, arvai, kathi pondra munai. Inge pathingina rings for fastening the wood to be hafted with the iron implement. here this is the scepter like portion sengul polo it is of more than a meter height with a what you call club like projection at the top or periya kai thadi irumbu irumbanaala kai thadi and these are all the ear ornaments terracotta ear ornaments you can have the closer view it has decoration some of them has decorations in the form of lotus floral metal petal leaves in four directions some has in six or eight with the central group even now we the age old ladies of the extreme south particularly madurai tirunelveli ramnad and right up to kanyakumari they have the floating earlobe ornament hanging in their earlobes and swinging like a pendulum the moment they just gently turn their head they will swing in early days they had the tendency whomsoever particularly the ladies whomsoever has the elongated earlobe are considered to be the more beautiful ladies and in Tamil they are termed as pambadam in Madurai and adjoining areas currently they state such ornament as tandatti once again the closer view of the spindle bone at the lower you can see the metal rod which is missing found stuck one on either side this is the metal rod you can see which is attached with the rusty which gives an indication how the cotton fibers were twisted with the help of this rudimentary or the prototype of the basic unit of converting the fibers into thread and which in turn taken to the yarn for making or converting it into cloth and here you can see the cords being cut and worn as ornaments in the form of bangles and ear ornaments or nose rings and apart from this we have also collected horns of many animals among the horns more than 55% are the horns recovered from Kiradi proved as per the report of Deccan College paleontologists proved the association of the settlement the people who lived in that contemporary period as that of agrarian based supportive animals cattle and besides cattle bulls and cows goats we also recovered bones of deers horns of deers bones of peacocks and bear so these use an indication of their domestication attitude as well as food habit you may ask were there no coins yes we also recovered coins of various types the one which is at the top it's a this one at the second row first the closer view is this which is of silver the other coins are of copper various shapes round square elongated panchamur coin this coin which I was showing the closer view is the panchamur coin which contains some punch designs and the square type of coins or the central one is a early Sangam age coin and the bigger coins are of that of the medieval times then the smaller coins are that of the Vijayanagara Nayak period mostly of copper except one
Now we can have the closer view of the outer cover, revealing the recovery of ring bell found from one of the excavated trenches. So when we take into consideration of all these points, and this season, during last season, we have unearthed a lengthy wall of measuring more than 16 meters in its length in 7 courses of brick. Yet another wall, it's not exactly wall, it is something like a closed water chute running to more than 6 meters in an S-shaped form, being created with a basally placed brick and on either extreme ends vertically placed breadthwise placed brick, and the top being covered with another brick at the top having center hole to let the water or any liquid to pass in and to be taken to the other end. So this gives an indication that they had the water tubes which existed in the second season, also existed during the fifth season, that is last year. And this year we have also confirmed the second season architectural remains of the second season architectural remains of Archaeological Survey of India from the adjoining localities of laying a few trenches, the same kind of the water passages being paved with bricks and another with subbed off the roofing tiles. The existence of roofing tiles gives an indication, along with post holes, gives an indication that they could have had a roof over their brick structures in order to protect this livelihood or some kind of their industrial activity. Well, if we take the weaving industry or dyeing unit during rainy season, it is to be protected from the wrath of rain. So for which they had the roof made of wooden post planted into the ground and over which being fastened across with the rafters, and above it the roof tiles, which generally has 3 grooves and 2 holes, which is of nearly 30 centimeters length and 20 to 22 centimeters width. They have been placed one over the other with the help of the two holes. They could have been tied with the rafters, and as the whole portion is being covered by the overlying roof tile and the extreme top being covered with some kind of coverage, thereby not to let in the water into the house or the dwelling places or any industrial activity chamber like. So in that way, this proves its might. Last season, in one of the trenches at the lower most level, just above the natural soil, there is a what we call a lengthy L-shaped in 3 cut faces, has charcoal mixed and the periphery being hardened due to reddishness. That is, whenever any heating activity is being done with the rammed clay earth, which becomes hardened and it turns to be terracotta. In that way, such a type of two existence at the platform at the lowest level, that is just above the natural soil, which is nothing but the coated invariably in villages in early days, because as I hail from a village very near Kumbakonam, Pandanallur, during early days of conducting ceremonies like marriages and other functions, people used to have a long pit cut at the rear backyard of their houses, and wherein that pit will be converted as a firing oven like, by which they can place too many andas and hundas for cooking. The vessels could be placed and the firewood could be inserted at the intervening spaces, and thereby they will cook for large scale gatherings. So in that way, Kirdi has also at the lowest depth this kind of what you call the firing activity to serve to the requirement of a good congregation, which could have existed during that phase of cultural accumulation So Kiredi, on the basis of these points, we will come to a conclusion. It is definitely not an urban site, not a habitation site. In fact, which is an agrarian based settlement, so taking the support or giving a lineage to the cottage industries which might have existed, namely pottery making, weaving, dyeing, bead making, shell bangle making. In last season, one trench contained just the raw material, that is the silica. So a trough contained silica, silicaceous material, which gives an indication definitely glass making industry might also existed at Kiredi. And besides, iron smelting activity could have also been noticed in some of the trenches. So based on this, Kiredi has become a real eye opener as for the historical perspectives of the Tamils are concerned, and above all, on the basis of the inscriptions, we can very well state. Let me recall the legacy of a Brahmi inscription. Ashoka, during his tenure, has issued royal charters in the form of rock edicts, pillar edicts, minor and major rock edicts, and pillar edicts. Of all the major rock edicts, rock edict number 213 clearly states, "My southern boundary comprises of the kingdoms ruled by the Cholas, Pandyas, Keralaputras, and Satyaputra," which means that though Ashoka happens to be the mighty emperor who had his dominion stretching from Afghanistan, Balochistan, covering the entire nation of the Indian subcontinent, except the portions of the southern peninsular region, namely the kingdoms, it is as per his charter statement. I am quoting it. It's not a Tamil inscription. It is the inscription as per the direction of the Ashoka, Emperor Ashoka, which was written, engraved, particularly rock edict 2 and 30, which states, "My southern boundary comprises of the kingdoms ruled by Cholas, Pandyas, Keralaputras, and Satyaputra," which gives a clinching issue that he was not dominant enough throughout his empire. He was unable to enter into the Tamil land during that contemporary period because of the stiff resistance given by, although the Tamil rulers who divided themselves among themselves and ruled separately, but when a common enemy came, they had given a resistance to prove their what you call cultural milieu and as a single unit that they belong to protect the cultural entity and identity of the Tamils. And as a result, he was unable to penetrate into the Tamil land to take his religious mission, and for which he assigned his son and daughter, Mahendra and Sangamitra. Although it could also be the other view, because having taken the, having seen the atrocious nature of the war footing at Kalinga, Emperor Ashoka might have made his mind not to conquer by invasion, and in turn to conquer every nation through dharma, on righteous path, following the basic principles of Lord Buddha. So in that context, he was unable to take his missionary, and as a result, we had only sporadic centers of Buddhist centers, as Buddhapedu, Nagapattinam, and other areas, only such localities. Even Arikamedu is Arikanmedu, was its earlier name. So these are all the indications how the Tamil land had only sporadic localities of Buddhist impact, and most of the influences had penetrated into South and Southeast Asian nations, even Sri Lanka. Although the religion was had its origin in the Indian subcontinent from Pataliputra and adjoining areas, it had its penetration and deep-rooted in Chinese, Japanese, and what you call Southeast Asian nations, including
the adjoining territory of the Indian subcontinent, Sri Lanka. But it doesn't have that much concentration. So in that way, Ashokan Brahmi has given a leverage for the existence of the Tamil Brahmi scribed shirts. It's not Tamil Brahmi, it is Tamil shirts. Hereafter, we can call as Tamil letter inscriptions recovered, datable to 580 BC, 6th century BC, is the real precursor of the literacy level which existed in different handwriting. 58 shirts revealed 58 type of handwriting. In one such shirt, there was a striking, that is overwriting by the individual. Because, for example, when we attend in the early days of our schooling or colleges, when the teacher gives some information by writing on the board, and if we strike out some word, immediately we also strike on the notebook with a pen, overwriting, in order to strike off. In a similar way, one such shirt has revealed the overwriting attitude of the individual buyer for his conception or utility. He might have written some name and he had overwritten it by striking it in three or four lines. So this is how the writing, the material remains of Kiradi has proven its might as not only an industrial site, it is an agrarian based urban center being supported with many cottage industries. And above all, in the present scenario, the excavation is being conducted in the adjoining areas of Kiradi, hardly 1 kilometer or 1.5 kilometers of a cross flight through sky. When we have a look at and measure the distance, it will hardly of 1 kilometer radius located on the eastern side, Manalur Agaram, after the Manalur Kanmai. Manalur Kanmai forms the eastern boundary of Kiradi mound of more than 110 acres of land. And similarly, on the southern side exists Kondahai, which is nothing but the burial site contemporary to that of Kiradi site. And this season we have taken up and we have laid 8 trenches. From those trenches, more than 25 urns were recovered, and pit burials, primary burials, were also being identified. And we have also collected the bone samples, and the same has been sent to Madras Kamaraj University scientific team for DNA analysis. And the moment they give us the date, that will naturally be added in the present report, which is to come in the near future. So with all this, present and current scenario of information, I could give you a panoramic view of Kiradi. And in fact, this is the new vistas of Kiradi archaeological finds, throwing much limelight to the Tamil culture, which existed 2,600 years before present. And let me once again thank the organizers of Nandanam History Club, History Department, in particular, Professor Thangaraj, also being associated with fellow fraternities, because I do not know their full names of each and every one of them. And similarly, the technical team, which supported the presentation to go ahead without any, disturbances or interactions. And similarly, let me keep a word of thanksgiving attitude to the principal who supports every such academic activity to be performed just for the cause of the academic pursuit, taste and thirst of many young historians, archaeologists, information seekers, public, and above all, students. So in this way, let me once again thank my professor mentor, Professor K.V. Raman, and other teachers who have contributed their level right from my studentship, from my primary level, and above all, to my parents and to the nature. And as far as Kiradi is concerned, to this minute, we have not recovered any religious sign or object. So which gives an indication, it is only from 6th century the interpolation of Sanskrit has been introduced into the Tamil culture. And the very good example is the existence of the Bhakti literature. In none of the Bhakti literature verses, you can find even a single word of Sanskrit. For example, let us take Devaram. Devaram gives the name of the place or the Lord only in Tamil terms. Of course, with the slight interpolation of the Sanskrit, injection. But as far as the place names are concerned, definitely all the places have been mentioned only in Tamil. For example, Vedaranyam, the earlier term referring Vedaranyam is Tirumaraikkadu. Similarly, Vrudachalam was referred in the Bhakti literature as Tirumudugundram. And similarly, Kuramuk was the earlier name, referred both by the Naimas as well as the Alvars. They have given sung the praise of the Lord of their respective faith. So in this context, it was only Adi Shankara clearly states, who happens to be of the 6th century AD, states the existence of six type of religion during his contemporary times, which was nothing but Shanmadam. What are the six type of religion which existed during his period of 6th-7th century? It was nothing but, to start with, Sauram, Saktam, Saivam, Vainavam, Kaumaram, Ganapatyam. Ganapatyam entered into the Tamil land only after conquering Chalukya king Pulakesan by Narasimha the First, the son and successor of Mahendra. In fact, Mahendra was defeated by Pulakesan the First, Chalukya ruler, contemporary ruler, and taking this as a oath in his mind. He had waged war when he became the king. He waged war to the Chalukyan territory, and wherein at Badami there exists an inscription of what we call Narasimha Varma, which clearly states that I overempowered, I have defeated the Chalukyan ruler Pulakesan, whom actually defeated my father in the earlier battle. And as a result, the war trophy, not only their precious metal objects or artisan other people, they also brought in one image of Ganesha. That is why Vadaping Gadapati, that poetic phrase comes into existence in practice of the later Tamil works as being quoted in the later versions. So prior to that, we do not have Ganapati. So in that context, the Tamils initially worshipped nature from the prehistoric times. Then they have taken up Saktam, that is the fertility cult, the mother goddess worship. And one such specimen exists, the Visiri Kal or the Paravai Kal, Udayar Natham, very near what you call the Natharkad. Physical. It is something like a stretched winged bird shaped out of a large shaped stone slab. It is a clear cut indication that which projects the mother goddess or mother goddess cult which existed. So Saktam emerged, and this Saktam had taken the form as Saptamatrikas, Yed Kandi Margaret. So later, Saivam came into being because they could have wondered how the progeny might have emerged. So as a result, they could have worshipped the phallus worship. The earliest form exists in Andhra Pradesh, Gudimallam, which doesn't have the, the central portion or the basal portion. It has only the phallus. Saivam came into being, and human activity might have rose him as a king or a royal personality in that attitude. The Vainava might have came into being. Then the next level of progeny, that is Kaumaram, Kumaran in Tamil. Kumaran indral, Magan indra artham. அடுத்த நிலையாளரை அழைக்கக்கூடிய நிலையிலே தான் இந்த கௌமாரம் வந்திருக்க வேண்டும். கௌமாரத்துக்கு பிறகு காணபத்திரம் இங்கே வடக்கிலிருந்து தான் வந்திருக்கிறதே தவிர இங்கே அந்த சமகாலத்தில் நிலவே இல்லை என்பதை அறுதியிட்டு என்னால் சொல்ல முடியும். அதற்கு நரசிம்ம முதலாம் நரசிம்மன் பல்லவ சாளுக்கிய மன்னன் புலகேசியை பாதாமி என்னும் அவருடைய நகரத்திலேயே சென்று வாகை சூடி அங்கே அவன் ஏற்படுத்திருக்கக்கூடிய கல்வெட்டு இதை நமக்கு பறைசாற்றுவதாகத்தான் இருக்கிறது. இந்த நிலையிலே அசோகர் காலத்துக்கு முன்பே இங்கே வந்து தமிழன் எழுத்தருமை எழுத்தறிவு உயர்ந்த நிலையில் பெற்ற நிலையிலே தனக்கென்று ஒரு எழுத்தை கொண்டிருந்திருக்கிறான். அது பின்னணி என்ன ஆகிறது? அங்கே வடக்கிலிருந்து வந்து சமஸ்கிருதத்துடைய தாக்கம் என்ற நிலையிலே அது எடுத்து ஏம்பப்பட்டிருக்கிறது. இதையெல்லாம் வைத்து பார்க்கும் போது தமிழனுக்கு என்று ஒரு குணம் உண்டு. அது நிச்சயமாக மனப்புடன் சிறப்புடன் சிறந்து விளங்கி இருக்கிறது என்பதை இந்த அகழ்வாயு கூறுகள் எச்சங்கள் எல்லாம் நமக்கு பறைசாற்றி கொண்டிருக்கிறது. சோ ஒன்ஸ் அகைன் ஐ தேங்க் எவ்ரி இண்டிவிஜுவல் கம்ப்ரைசிங் ஆஃப் the galaxy of the what you call academic group which has given me a platform being led by Professor Thangaraj and the team to express my views and experience gained in all these years of more than 3 decades in the channel of archaeology, history and Tamil culture. Thank you one and all. If you have any personal questions you can post it to me. Thank you so much for patient hearing.
Thank you sir. Sir, thank you sir for your work.
Thank you.
And the express his view of archaeology and especially in the field exploration. Sir, the question are the
okay.
Just a minute, definitely wait please sir.
Sure.
Sir, one of the participants.
Sure sir. Your name is sir.
Sir, what is your comment on the artistic sense of the people based on the founding?
Artistic
sense. Sense of the people based on the findings.
Because it shows the high workmanship. They were all grown-ups. For example, let me take the bangle pieces. Cut out of the conch. It is not that easy because it is to be initially heated and it is not that easy in the rudimentary level. 2600 years old period. They have okay. Perfectly cut without any what you call breakages, perfectly given the shape without having what you call serrations which may cut the skin of the ladies to be worn in their hands. They were having the smooth surfaces. Similarly, Vadamalai Paranda Maniyum Punnum, the Sangam literature once again comes to our rescue. What are all the commodities which were brought into the port town of the Sangam Cholas, Kavari Pumbatinum, Vadamalai Paranda Maniyum Punnum, குடமல பிறந்த அகிலும் துகிரும் ஈழத்துணவும் காழகத்து ஆக்கவும் the finished products. ஈழத்துணவு means the food products from Sri Lanka. காழகத்து ஆக்கம் the finished products from கேடா which is nothing but Burma or the present day Southeast Asian countries were all brought in to the port town of Kaveri Pombatinum or Kumbhar. Similarly, வடமலை பிறந்த மணியும் பொண்ணும் the occurrence of these semi precious stone beads which is not that easy to be shaped even in the present scenario unless we have a machinery lathe and machinery can alone can shape that perfectly spherical or barrel shape tubular otherwise they will naturally get brittle and get into pieces torn into pieces. They have such a workmanship. And similarly, when we have the look at the golden ornaments, it shows the high profile of the artistic artisan nature of workmanship. Sokla Tangam.
Okay, sir. Sir, next question, the same participant asking the question.
Okay.
Are there any evidences in the antiquities for the influence of ideas from outside the Kiladi settlement?
As far as settlement is concerned, it is locally made by the people, for the people who lived in and around, supporting the existed other localities through their finished products like the beads, bangle pieces, potteries, and many thousands might have got taken to the other localities in and around the adjoining areas, and just to have their commercial activity, they could have taken it. But this is purely meant for the people who survived in the vicinity of Kiladi to cater to their requirements. And one such find I can point out once again, the rowletted ware, which we have recovered from Kiladi, the particular variety, that is the imitated version of rowletted ware. It is an indigenous ware, but the technique has been imported, which has come all the way from the Roman world, because that technique existed only at the initial stage, existed only at the Roman sites. So, which have been incorporated and adapted by the local potter. So, it could have attracted, the design could have attracted. In a similar way, we also have the ornaments or what you call the dress patterns. For example, people who come from Malaysia, they always have some kind of dragonic figured shirts and other things. Similar shirts, our weavers also make in order to attract them. Though it is locally made, our people who have such taste will naturally buy such clothing. So in that way, it is an important technique. But
okay. Sir, like, one more participants. The name is Achay Lakshmi.
Okay.
Could you show the Gamsman picture? One second, sir.
Yeah, sure.
See, asking one more.
Sure. I'll show the better.
Would it be possible you to write it, sir?
Yes, it is possible. This is a closer view of the hopscotches.
Okay.
இது வந்து சில்லுகோடு பட்டச்சில்லுன்னு பேருது in Tamil we call it as in Madurai and adjoining areas they call it as pandikai and this is a pagadakai. This is a gamesman. You can see the shape. And some of the gamesman pieces were also made of ivory. Most of them are of terracotta. Is it clear now? Hello. Is it clear?
Anybody? Okay. வணக்கம் சார்.
சார், ஒரு யங் சைடுல ஒரு க்வெஸ்சன் இருக்கு சார். வை கீழடி ரோயின்னு கேக்குறாங்க சார்.
யாரோ ஆஸ்க் பண்றாங்க யார்.
வை கீழடி ரோயின்ட்.
யார் சார் இது? சார், அதை அன்மியூட் பண்ணுங்க அதை.
ஹலோ.
ஓகே சார்.
What is the question, please?
Why Kiladi ruined?
Can you repeat the question? It's not audible.
Why Kiladi ruined?
Sir, could you show the
Kiladi ruined? Ruined, okay. One is a natural phenomenon. Because as this is very adjacent to River Vaigai.
Okay.
During flood season, it could have flooded the entire area.
Okay.
And as a result, Kiladi site contains only one phase of cultural sequence, and as a result they could have migrated to the nearby elevated area after a few centuries of their livelihood at Kiladi.
Okay, thank you.
I can point out the very recent flood in Chennai could have turned some of the low lying settlements
to shift their settlement to the higher platform. Okay, if this is the case, even the 21st century, think of 26 centuries earlier, what could have been the scenario?
Okay, sir. If anybody questions, sir, dear participant, anybody questions here?
Sir, nothing, sir. So thank you very much, sir.
Palani sir, any questions, sir? Palani sir.
Sir, illa sir.
No question. Okay.
Sir, Mansoor sir, kudunga.
Okay, sir. I call you, Professor Muhammad Mansoor, to deliver what of thanks.
Mansoor, good evening, sir. Ladies. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I am on behalf of the PG Department of Historical Studies, Government Arts College, Nandanam, and on behalf of organizers and on my own behalf, would like to thank our beloved principal and patron, Dr. R. Jayachandran, sir, for having given the permission to conduct the 5 days international level faculty development program on recent trends in historical, cultural, and architecture from 5th to 9th of this month. I appreciate and acknowledge the effort shown by the convener of the program, Dr. D. Thangarajan, sir, who happens to be the professor and head Department of Historical Studies, the organizing secretaries, Dr. M. Pardi, sir, and Dr. R. Muniyappan, sir, and the program coordinator, Dr. R. Radhakrishnan, sir, and other faculties of the department for having shown keen interest to make this program to reach its desired goal destiny. We sincerely acknowledge our sense of gratitude to our today's resource person, Dr. M. Cheran, sir, an expert archaeologist, to Government of Tamil Nadu, State Department of Archaeology. Sir, during his lecture, sir has highlighted various excavation work that has taken place right from 1863 to till the recent excavation work at Keeladi. Narrating about the works carried out by Robert Brucewood to Mortimer Wheeler and to Amanath Ramakrishnan, who happens to be the in charge of Keeladi excavation work. During his lecture, sir has pointed out the richness of international trade relationship between Tamil country and Greco-Roman world during the ancient period. His mastery over the subject made him to deliberate on various issues from artifacts to hero stone, from habitation mounds to urn burial, and has pointed out that apart from Keeladi, excavation works are still going on at the adjacent to Keeladi, that is like places like Manalur, Kondagai. Sir has not only shown varieties of pictures like spindles, hopscotches, carnelian stones, ceramic stones, beads, terracotta stones, potteries, wells, and so on. Sir has rightly pointed out that Keeladi was an agrarian-based urban site. And sir has deliberated on various issues pertaining to Keeladi. His lecture threw light on the ongoing excavation at Keeladi. The findings at Keeladi not only brought the rich cultural heritage of Tamil people, but also to a great extent will enable us, as in the sense to the writers of history, to rewrite the history of India with a new perspective. I also would like to appreciate the sense of participation by the participants, their enthusiasm, and participants from within and outside India. We could able to see their questions also. We urge you all to stay connected with us with the rest of the day's program. Finally, we are thankful to the technical coordinators like Vivekanandan Muthuswamy sir and Dr. R. Kodan Raman sir, who is not only the librarian of our college, but also was also a student of our department. Participants, kindly fill up the feedback form and send your opinion for the betterment of the program. Tomorrow's program will start at around 3 p.m. Thank you very much for...
3:30.
Tomorrow's 3:30. The program will start at 3:30. Stay connected with us. Thank you very much for your participation. As Walter has said, the history of the people is the real history. No one is going to stop the history of Tamilians, which is going to take a center stage in the history of India. Thank you very much. Good day.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can I talk to Professor Thangaraj, sir?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Can I? So kind of you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Okay.